here's one that you'll like. In the waste report, $3.1 billion was spent in less than a decade to pay for leave for government employees that were suspected of wrongdoing for vacations and other benefits.
What?
Just
so
you know.
That's B with a billion.
With a B, with a billion. This is my concern when people get into retirement plans. No cash flow, and I believe in cash flow over accumulation. Mm-hmm. Restrictions, a partner that is deeply addicted to money and deeply addicted to taxing you, right? A bunch of fees in addition to the funds that are inside of that. There's also administration fees, and at least you can look for lower cost things. You're invested in companies you know nothing about that you might not even believe in and that might not even be around because of technological change. And yet this is the notion of how we're supposed to do it in America. Money can be complicated. Let a nerd help you. We're here to demystify the complex nature of money by getting you answers from financial nerds and whiz kids. Welcome to Ask the Money Nerds, a weekly segment of the Wealth Labs podcast where we answer your most pressing money questions. When is the right time to take money from a retirement plan and for what? What's considered an investment and why do you have the money there in the first place? Is compound interest the only way to grow your wealth or is it maybe overrated? Said it. Compound interest may be overrated. Seriously, what good is money in a plan if you never access it or use it? So, what are your options? This is going to be a good one, Stolba.
I think it's going to be a really good one. Can you just tell us a little bit about the myth around compound interest?
Well, let's just think about this for just a moment. If you're an institution, bank, you're a mutual fund company, you're Wall Street, what do you want from people?
Their money.
How often?
As often as you can get it.
How long do you want to hold on to it for?
As long as I can.
And how much do you want to give them back when they want to take a withdrawal?
Very little.
Okay, so the first thing is in this accumulation philosophy, they want you to believe that it takes money to make money, that high risk equals high return, and the best things come to those who wait. That's their three mantras. So it's money times rate times time. It's very linear, but it looks exponential over time. So compound interest in the first 10 years looks anemic. It's slow. Because what it is you're earning interest and then you just put the interest right back into the account and now you're getting interest on your interest, right? Sounds great. And if everything goes according to plan in 30 years, you'd have a lot of growth. But if you have down years, if you have unexpected fees or hidden fees, if you just have volatility over time, if you have companies in that mutual fund that go out of business, if you realize how you're being skimmed from flash trading, which is taking away from your returns. When you understand the difference between an average return or an actual return. So if you have 100 grand, you lose 10%, you're at 90 grand.
Yep.
If you get 10% on 90 grand, 99,000 before fees. And those fees come out whether you make money or not. So some people try to go index funds and lower the fees, which I think could be good because most fund managers usually don't outperform. There are some hedge funds that have heavily outperformed for long periods of time. There's other hedge funds that just reduce volatility. And a hedge fund means that you have less restrictions. They can trade how they want. They can use derivatives or options. They can be in growth at one time. They can all be in cash, where a traditional mutual fund has restrictions that if it's a growth fund, they keep it in growth stocks. If it's a bond fund, they keep it in bonds, whether it's time to move to cash or not. But with hedge funds, because there is so much latitude, there are a lot of hedge funds that actually get, you know, decimated. And there's other hedge funds that you get the wealthiest people that get really good returns sustainably. But a lot of it comes down to the talent and the managers and the analysis that they have and their overriding philosophy. So
now those hedge funds, if I'm understanding this correctly, have a very deep impact on the individual investor, right?
Well, not only that, from investing with them, if they're large enough and they're making heavy enough trades, they can actually move the market, right? Because if you're dealing with an option and you're buying on margin, so you've got a small amount of money that you're using to buy more shares, that could actually make a movement. Or you're a huge hedge fund with a lot of money. Well, that, you know, if you sell a company, that might have a little bit of an impact. Now, obviously, you're dealing with the biggest of the biggest to make that happen. Like, you know, even if you're extraordinarily wealthy, one individual and you buy a stock, it's probably not going to move the price substantially. But at the same time, you know, if all hedge funds are taking a similar position, or most of them are, like they're selling short, then, you know, they expect the market to go down. Mm-hmm. You might start to see some of those things come to fruition. And look, 84% of the gains that happen in the market are from 10% of the investors.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. Like individual or independent investors, they're probably not aware of or following the hedge funds that are also investing in the stocks that they are.
Yeah. So think about it. Like if part of the year, let's say overall the market goes up 6% in a year. Mm-hmm. And for part of that year, let's say a couple months, it was down. You know, there was a negative return. But some hedge funds made money during the downturn. Now, if most companies were losing during that time, how could they make money? Well, they made money because they sold short. They actually bought an option that says if the market goes down, they make money. Well, I don't know if it's going to make it angry. It's just, it's a very much a win-lose zero-sum game. Mm-hmm. It's very much, I'm betting it's going up, you're betting it's going down. And by the way, if you're just buying and holding, you're betting the market's going up. Mm-hmm. So if they bet an option, or they have an option that is a put, right? Put mm-hmm. means it's going to go down, that they actually get the gains because the money doesn't evaporate.
It's one person, transferred, right?
Yeah, it's transferred. And so when we go, oh, at the end of the year, there was a 6% return, but let's say some hedge fund does 13%. Well, there's other funds that might have done 2%. And so when we hear about market averages, what the S&P 500 or the Dow averages, averages don't really matter. What matters is your actual net return after expenses, after volatility, because we already went through the numbers that you'd have a 0% average if you lost 10% your first year and gained it the next year. Your average is 0%, mm-hmm. but the actual return was negative because you only had 10% of a lower amount.
Right.
So I really feel like compound interest is this notion that we're going to set money aside. We set it, forget it, invest early, often and always. We're going to bet on the American economy because it's always going to go up. But you know what? We're betting on companies. Like, we're not betting on the small business mm-hmm. that employ more people than major corporations. Yeah. They don't have the fiduciary rules that say you look out for the shareholder at all costs, which major corporations that are on a stock exchange are supposed to do mm-hmm. as a legal responsibility, which might mean asking the employees to do twice as much. Or cutting their benefits mm-hmm. or, you know, or treating their customers just good enough to keep them, but not good enough to actually do something good in this world. Mm-hmm. And that's why I think you see so much frustration with some of this, some of these big organizations. Now, there are great big companies that do amazing things in the world and provide great products mm-hmm. and they navigate this pretty well, but there's plenty of companies that all they give a shit about is what that stock price is. So when they IPO, they cash out. It used to be that when you did an IPO, that's an initial public offering, mm-hmm. right? So you're a private company, you're going public.
Right.
The reason we have the stock market, I think, was a pretty cool reason.
Why is that?
Let's say that you have this big idea. And like, let's say before FedEx existed, Fred goes, I want to get things overnight. Now to build a worldwide network overnight mm-hmm. is going to require infrastructure, which is going to require some capital.
Yeah.
If you're a private business and you're trying to raise capital, you either have to borrow money mm-hmm. and say, here's the interest rate, I'll pay for that. Or you could say, I'll give up ownership in this, but they go, okay, well, how do I sell my ownership in a private market? There might not be liquidity. There might not be people going, yeah, I'm willing to buy that, because there's not, how do you get that evaluation? Well, you have to go pay for the valuation, and then you have to find someone that's willing to buy. And yeah, there's pretty big private companies that it's easier to sell that, because people understand there's higher value and there's things called arbitrage we won't get into.
Yeah.
But when we look at a big company like that, they can go public. They can raise funds through that by giving up stock, which is equity in the company. Mm-hmm. And so when there's a dividend and you're a stockholder, you get that dividend, right? But you have more risk than a bondholder, because if you don't make it as a business mm-hmm. and they sell off your assets, they're supposed to pay the bondholders first before they pay the stockholders. So typically bonds are supposed to pay a lower interest rate or have less upside potential. Mm. Okay. Because mm-hmm. one's a debt instrument. That's a bond. That's a debt instrument.
Okay.
And one's an equity instrument. That's a stock.
Yeah.
In liquidation, the bondholders have higher priority than the stockholders, unless the government interferes like they did with GM, but that's another story.
I didn't know that.
You know, so it's that's helpful to understand. And so when they first go, yeah, we're just going to raise capital. Awesome. Now you have a public market that people could buy and trade and sell from day to day. So they have liquidity. Mm-hmm. because they just go right there. You see them on the floor. Okay. And we're selling. And then, but if the demand goes down because you get information like Enron's lying, all of a sudden nobody wants to buy that because it was all built on artificial information. That's why we have auditing and we have rules and the SEC, right? There's all these kind of things, but it doesn't mean that people don't still find ways to, you know, cook the books is a phrase that you might hear, or, you know, make it look better than it actually is, because there's major pressure because they're trying to keep their job and they're trying to keep their shareholders happy. And if you get at a certain size, you might have someone else that comes with a leverage buyout to get you out of there, even though you don't want to sell. So it becomes a very shark infested water at a certain point. So I don't love this idea of companies that are in major negative cash flow, but they go into the media and they have great media teams to get everybody excited about WeWork and get everybody excited about Uber, but it's absolutely just getting decimated from a cash flow standpoint. But people are speculating and saying, I think this is the way of the future. And then they look at all the media out there talking about all that. So they're buying something without fundamental cash flow sense, simply because they think it's going to be something. And look, that worked for Instagram. You know, sold for $1 billion. That thing's grown because Facebook had a pretty big infrastructure and they saw that this was something, you know, that, you know, there's a different clientele on Instagram for the most part than there is Facebook, right? So that worked, even though it didn't have all the business fundamentals, because it was riding a very hot wave or topic and that made sense for them to buy that infrastructure and that innovation. So when I look at all this, I just don't personally love the thought of handing my money over into companies that I wouldn't want to do business with, but somehow I'm going to own stock in, and especially these newer ones that are just looking for the liquidation event so that now they can have all of their money and they just hand it off to, you know, whoever else that then when it went public. I just am not a huge fan of that. And we've seen less and less of companies going public over the last few decades, you know, because in the 90s, it was just internet companies just exploding, had no fundamentals, you know, nobody knew what was going on, and it was all based upon hype, and it's stabilized to a certain degree, but again, the stock market is artificially propped up, in my opinion. The reason is, people are putting money into retirement plans each and every month, regardless of what's going on in the economy. It's automatically taken out of their paycheck. If you were with a different employer,
I would
when you sign up, that most of them automatically enroll you in the 401k.
Yeah, isn't that newer? Because I remember when I was
teaching, been around for a while, but it's just becoming
in.
More popular.
Okay.
So it's been around for quite some time, but it's just now the majority. I mean, because think about it. If you're the financial institution selling the 401k administration that, hey, we'll be your administrator, and we're getting paid a percentage of what's in there, they're just thinking they want your money as often as possible, hold on to it for as long as possible, and give back the least possible. And with retirement plans, think about this. It follows those four rules brilliantly. Because if you want it before 59 and a half, what typically happens in a retirement plan?
You have to pay a penalty to get access to
money. And you like
money.
The word penalty because it scares the shit out of me. I was in Catholic school. You know,
get slapped on the hand with the ruler.
So penalty, people are afraid of the penalty. And, you know, and they haven't paid taxes yet. So this notion of tax deferral has people feel like they're saving tax. But they're delaying tax. It's two very different things. So yes, you pay less tax this year because it's not in your pocket when you put in the money in the plan. It's in the plan where your FBO for benefit of. So it's a 401k, which is a tax code, which means if the government chooses to change the rules, they can. And I don't know about you. Do you think the government might raise taxes in the future?
100%.
Like doing a retirement plan is like doing a business deal with a heroin addict that tells you they promise you in the future they're not going to be on heroin anymore. Like the government's heroin is tax, because if they don't have the tax, how do they run the programs? And what I've seen is there's more programs and more waste and more nonsense, not less. So
they're
efficient. I don't want to be in partnership with them. I mean, here's the deal. When you do that plan, at least you know your money's going to good use, right? When it goes to taxes.
That's
true stories. $391,000 was spent by the government for these cups, these coffee cups for the Air Force that was supposed to keep everything heated so that they could have their coffee for extended period of time. I don't know. It was 391 grand that they spent on these things, and they broke too easily. Now, you know, like there's some, I've done too much research. Here's one that you'll like in the waste report. $3.1 billion was spent in less than a decade to pay for leave for government employees that were suspected of wrongdoing for vacations and other benefits.
What?
Just
that's
so you know.
That's B with a billion.
With a B, with a billion. So anyway, I don't want to get you too far off track, but this is my concern when people get into retirement plans. No cash flow, and I believe in cash flow over accumulation. Restrictions, a partner that is deeply addicted to money and deeply addicted to taxing you, right? A bunch of fees in addition to the funds that are inside of that. There's also administration fees, and at least you can look for lower cost things. You're invested in companies you know nothing about that you might not even believe in and that might not even be around because of technological change. And yet this is the notion of how we're supposed to do it in America. We're supposed to not think, hand it over, and hope it's going to work out. Well, the news is in. 95% of people are not economically independent at age 65. 70-some million people are doing these plans.
We should all be concerned about that number. If the plan that they're advocating is supposed to be what sets us free when we decide to retire, and 95% of the population has not gotten there, that's a red flag. We got to look at it. So the things that you're talking about, we have to unlearn and relearn a new way.
And here's the good and the bad of it. It all begins with personal responsibility.
Yeah.
We've been told it's too complicated. You don't have the time. Trust the experts. Most of those experts are salespeople. Not experts.
Yeah.
The track record's not there. This isn't working. But because we don't want to do the work, we just continue with it. So I would even begin with questioning the notion of retirement. Like, if you won the lottery tomorrow and you quit your job, it's time to find another job. Now, some people are told, hey, in this COVID era world, you should just be grateful for any work. But that is trying to push us to the lowest common denominator, where we don't recognize our talents and gifts. And we trade time for money and we lose our life day by day. So I don't have a 401k. I had one at one time. I cashed that thing out and I have a terrible joke. Just be ready to hear it for the eighth time because you've been around me too much. But I cashed mine out, paid the 10% penalty because I looked at it like that 10% is like if I get a loan right now that was 10% in year one and 0% for the life of the loan, would I get that loan? You bet. After 10 years, that's 1% a year. After 20 years, it's 0.5% a year. Like, I'm cool with that. So to get access to my money, and plus I made a lot less then, so even my tax rate was lower, so it wasn't that big of a deal. And I put a yard in the house that I had bought. And so when everybody was complaining about their 401k going down in value in 2008, I'm like, I can't get mine to stop growing. I have to trim it all the time. Super annoying. No, but thanks for laughing. Give me a courtesy laugh
courtesy
there.
Laugh,
but,
yeah.
But this is the entire format that we're in. Now, if you have these plans, there's options. One that is a slightly improved option. If you have a lower tax year this year, you can move to a Roth regardless of how much you make because you have a one-time conversion, but you have to pay the taxes, right? If you pay it from the plan, you might even have a penalty issue, so you have to pay those taxes separately. Number two, you can get the money out during COVID up to $100,000 without the 10% penalty. You could pay all the tax in this year or spread it out for the next 2 years afterwards, depending on when you watch this video, because we're filming it right now in 2020.
Yes.
You can roll it over to a self-directed IRA. You might be able to get a fixed fee, so you minimize some of the drag there, and you might be able to invest it in things other than mutual funds because it opens you up to more options. But more options are not always better because sometimes people go invest in really speculative things that might not be good for them because they don't know anything about it, but they're chasing that dollar. Or you could always cash that out. Now, if you do, people are like, why would you do that? You're going to interrupt the compound interest curve because, you know, I did a reaction video to Susie recently and she was like, just stay strong, keep that money in the retirement plan. I'm like, so you have no income coming in and you're supposed to keep the money in there so you don't interrupt compound interest. But at the same time, you have this compounding cost called borrowing money. And right now, the borrowing rate for a lot of people, if you're in perfect condition from your finances and everything, is super low, so it may not be bad. But for a lot of people, as you've seen from other Ask the Money Nerds questions, is double digit, as high as 22%, 29%, I think is the worst that we've seen on these loans. And the best thing you could do is cash this thing out and save that compounded cost, because compound interest goes this way and it becomes exponential. Compound interest cost goes this way and becomes exponential on the drag that it creates for you.
Yeah.
So I know you didn't even get to the question, so we'll just do that on another video, because this was just a little bit of a rant that I think was essential for people to understand in very common language, just to question the system that we're under. If that's what you want to do, it's not like these are the worst plans in the world. I just think that they have inherent risk that most people aren't talked about or told about, and that they just hope that it's all going to work out, and they find out when it's too late. So they gave up their entire dream and their entire life so that one day when they were told retirement was going to be a dream, it turns out to be a nightmare because interest rates are too low like they are today. So that's really tough on retirees. Taxes go up. All of a sudden it cuts into their fixed income, or inflation starts to creep in and starts to confiscate their purchasing power. And what they thought was going to be the best years of their life become the most stressful years of their life. And that is just a travesty. And I'm here to make sure that people have the information so they can make more informed decisions, take responsibility, take back control of their personal finances, and turn their thoughts into profits so they could build the life they love. Worried your 401k is going to turn into a 201k? Want to know if you can ever get to your money? Whether these plans are right for you or not? Well, I've got some videos on it. Just go ahead and click right here.